Hello and welcome to RCGC Today. I'm your host, Diane Carbonetta. Rowan College at Gloucester County recently met with the Gloucester County Chamber of Commerce to sign the Chamber of Commerce Education Partnership. Here to tell us a little bit about this new partnership, we have Les Vail, President and CEO of the Gloucester County Chamber of Commerce, and Dr. Patricia Claghorn, Dean of Business Studies. Thank you both so much for being here today.
Well, thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Absolutely. So, Les, can you tell me a little bit about what inspired this new partnership?
You know, one of the unique things about Gloucester County is that we have this ability to want to work together, you know, and when you look around the state, you know, you don't have that same synergy. And, you know, this started with a conversation with Dr. Fred Keating, who was one of our board members, and just started, I just want to run something by you. And then the conversation turned to, well, let's have another conversation. And then he brought his team together. And, you know, after a couple of meetings, you know, this whole concept of creating this educational partnership for our members and their employees really just sprung, because it really is, when you look at economic development, where does economic development really start? It starts with workforce development. And if we can provide resources to the business community to hire and recruit and train and educate the best workforce, then we become a region that people want to be in. So it really was, I like to say I could take credit. It was actually Dr. Keating's idea who came up with the idea and the concept and just brought it to me and said, what do you think? You think this is something that we can do? And from there, it just was a whirlwind over the last 2 months of trying to get everything together. And there's nothing like it out there. There's nothing like it out there in the state. There's no other county college, no other chamber that we found through Googling that's doing anything like this.
So the partnership will offer a 33% discount to chamber members and their employees. Is there anything specific that people have to do to qualify?
Well, yes, there is actually a verification form. I mean, obviously, they'll go through the same enrollment process that an employee would go through. They'd go through Dr. Claghorn's the business score. You know, she's going to oversee this. So they'll register at the school just like that. But then there's a verification form that we verify that they are an employee of this company. So the owner of the company has to verify that they are an employee. They'll have to provide a pay stub. And then there's a verification process from our end to verify that they are a member in good standing with the Gloucester County Chamber of Commerce.
And what has response been like so far from your membership?
It's been incredible. I mean, you know, we've just today we had a business card exchange at Kennedy Health Systems, and there's already five employees that were there. One of them actually they just hired, who was just talking about, I'm going back to school. I'm going to RCGC. Can this work? Can I use this? Actually, she said, are we a member? I was like, yes, you are. That's why we're here today. So it's been in 3 weeks. It's been phenomenal. After the state of the county, we really made a big public announcement after the press conference. The sheets went out the door. We had copies on every table, and you know, normally you get done an event and you know people leave all the stuff on the table. That's the one thing that was not left on the table. They were gone.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, it is.
So, Dr. Claghorn, what resources can RCGC offer to chamber members who are very excited to pursue their degree but might want a little guidance finding the right path?
Well, I guess that's where I'm going to come in. I'm going to be a liaison to those people. So maybe it's been a while since you've been in school. Maybe you've been thinking a long time about coming back. And maybe you have questions, concerns. You might not know which program would be the best fit. And so I'm going to act as a liaison. The people have questions, they can contact me, and then I'm going to put them in touch with the right people at the college, because as you know, there are so many services available to help people to get on the right track. So I'll kind of help them to find their best foot in the door.
Do you foresee any areas being particularly popular to chamber members?
Well, I'm thinking just because it's a business chamber that our division would be very popular, but if someone has long been thinking about another direction, because Les, through your chamber, you represent many different types of businesses.
Types of industries, yeah.
Right, so it could be a science, technology, engineering, and math area. It could be a health sciences area. So it's not just business, but I would think that we'll have people obviously interested in business studies, but wherever they want to go, we'll get them to the right door.
And what can people do if they want to find out more about this opportunity?
Well, they can contact me directly at the college through pclaghorn@rcgc.edu. They can certainly go to the chamber website. I imagine you have all the information at the Gloucester County Chamber website as well.
Well, it sounds like another great benefit of joining the Gloucester County Chamber of Commerce. Thank you both so much for stopping by to talk to us about
Thanks so much for having us.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank
you. We'll be back in a moment with more RCGC Today.
Discover a better way to pursue your education at Rowan College at Gloucester County. RCGC offers in-demand degrees, flexible schedule choices, and the best tuition value in New Jersey. Visit rcgc.edu to register.
Welcome back to RCGC Today. The spring semester has begun at Rowan College at Gloucester County, and that means that spring open house is right around the corner. Here to give us some details is Administrator of Outreach, Kristen White. Thank you so much for being here today.
You're welcome.
So can you tell us a little bit about what Spring Open House is and who should attend?
Sure. Well, it's our single biggest recruiting event at Rowan College. And it's really a showcase for the college where parents and students and families and community can come and see everything that the college has to offer and take advantage of that on a one-on-one basis or even a group basis through information sessions and campus tours.
Can you tell us a little bit about what people can expect to learn by attending?
Sure. There's that one-on-one advantage I told you about, where students and families can talk to deans and faculty, get more information about programs they might be interested in, career paths, really solidify some of the things that they've been thinking about. Juniors, seniors, that interest level is really high. They want to start really paying attention to what colleges they're going to. So in addition to the one-on-one advantage and all of that, students are represented, there's clubs, campus tours to see the campus, financial aid will be represented, so it runs the whole gamut of everything that the college has to offer.
Are there any benefits that students receive by attending the event that they might not receive otherwise?
Sure, absolutely. It's an opportunity also, if a student is interested in applying to the college, they could do that free the night of. If they have questions about financial aid and how are we going to do this, how are we going to pay for college, there are representatives from financial aid there who can talk about that, scholarship opportunities, and there's an information session involving the New Jersey Stars information.
Now, is this a student-centered event, or would there be advantages to, say, a parent attending?
Well, it's an advantage for families to attend together because parents can take advantage of that financial aid information. They're usually interested in asking questions about their student. They want to see the campus. They want to see how beautiful it is, how safe it is. What are the programs like? Even athletics. We have athletes who attend with parents, and they also have specific questions about a student and their athletic divisions, and those questions can be answered that night too.
Is this, should people register? And if so, how do they go about doing that?
It's a good idea to register, and we have all of the information on our open house page at rcgc.edu/open-house. There's a registration button, and it is free to attend.
Is there any other information you'd like to add about the event?
Yes, we offer information sessions that night. I mentioned the New Jersey Stars information session, but also an information session about the Rowan University partnership, where students and families can hear more about the 3+1 program, Rowan Choice, and any other questions they have about or for Rowan University. In addition to that, we have our other partners at the open house as well. Wilmington University will be there, and Fairleigh Dickinson University can answer questions that students might have about transfer opportunities from Rowan College to those four-year schools.
Sounds like you guys have a lot going on. Thank you so much for stopping by to tell us about
it.
We'll be back in a moment with more RCGC Today.
Discover a better way to pursue your education at Rowan College at Gloucester County. RCGC offers in-demand degrees, flexible schedule choices, and the best tuition value in New Jersey. Visit rcgc.edu to register.
We're on location tonight at RCGC's basketball game and our first Women's Leadership Night. We want to thank, we have two guests with us, and we want to thank first Liz Pappas for coming back. She's an alumni and was recently inducted into the RCGC Alumni Hall of Fame. She was an athlete here, went on to be a leader in the education field, and also as a high school athletic director. So we wanted to, you know, thank you for coming back first off.
Thank you for asking me.
And then just ask you, Liz, you know, you came back, we had a great turnout for our women's basketball team. We had our softball team here, region champs, and some great female student athletes. What's it like for you to kind of see that and come back and have that welcome?
Brian, I can't tell you how overwhelmed with just a lot of happiness and just to see so many young kids putting time in at a community college and taking time to be a student athlete. It's just absolutely fantastic. And to see the crowd here tonight is a tremendous boost. I know why I decided to come here more than 40 years ago, and it was a long ride every day, more than 20 miles each way. So it's fantastic to see these kids, and I can't believe I asked you, do they still do National Women in Sports Day? And I got to meet the selection for Seton Hall in February, so it's just fantastic, and I can't thank you enough.
That's great. Well, you're certainly welcome, and you know, we thank you for coming back. And you mentioned here with us is also Lindsay Collins. Lindsay's a member of our women's softball team. As a freshman last year, batted 458, played the catcher position, was an All-American, and also most importantly, the thing we're most proud of, a 4.0 grade point average so far as a student here, and she balances that so well. We're getting ready to start the season. Lindsay was named tonight our female student athlete of the year. So represent us at National Women's in Sports Day up at Seton Hall University next week with her coaching staff. Lindsay, just tell us a little bit about what it means to you to be named our Female Student Athlete of the Year and to get this recognition tonight.
It means a lot to be the Female Student Athlete of the Year. There's a lot of great other female athletes in this school, and to be chosen out of everyone here is really an honor.
And Lindsay, obviously, success in the classroom, success on the field. You know, what about what you do has led you to be so successful? What's the secret to your success, I guess, is the question.
I think work ethic, just having a great work ethic is key. No matter where you are, whether you're in the classroom or on the field, hard work and dedication will get you far.
A great answer. I think you'd agree with that, right, Liz? A great answer. And again, we want to thank Liz for being here. And Lindsay, congratulations on your award. And again, this is our first Women's Leadership Night at our basketball game. We hope to have many more of them. We have with us now Megan Rutler, our head women's soccer coach. And coach is coming off a very successful season. Not only did the team win the region championship, but she was awarded the NSCAA Regional Coach of the Year Award. And Megan, it's got to have a good feeling for you to come out and see women's sports get to center stage tonight. We have your team here, the women's softball team, our women's tennis team here, the women's basketball team is doing so well. What is it about our women's sports program that really has done, you know, why are we so successful?
Well, I think first off, the college supports the athletic program. So with the support we get from the athletic department and the college in general, it's giving the women athletes a great opportunity to do something they're passionate about, use their free time in a productive way. And, you know, with success comes great self-esteem. So it's a great confidence booster for a lot of the women, the young women.
And Coach, one of the things I did want to ask you about was the honor you received as Coach of the Year. You know, that's got to feel great to you to be recognized by other coaches and an organization like the National Soccer Coaches Association.
Sure. Those that were in the running are excellent coaches. So to even be in that pool is an excellent honor. And to be selected by fellow coaches is surely something I'm proud of.
And we're really proud of this program. And I think what you've done from taking it from when you started to where it is now, you know, it just spells great success breeds more success, and that's something we want in all our women's sports teams. And the way you guys are supporting each other tonight, I think can carry over in the next season. And is that something you think might happen?
Yeah, I certainly hope so. I think it's important that, especially as, you know, young women, that we support each other and, you know, make certain that we have each other's backs in every aspect, whether it's supporting them here and you know, at a basketball game, or getting together in the lunchroom and, you know, checking in to see how we're doing academically.
Well, thanks again for coming on with us. Congratulations on your award, and we hope for continued success with this great program. Thanks.
Discover a better way to pursue your education at Rowan College at Gloucester County. RCGC offers in-demand degrees, flexible schedule choices, and the best tuition value in New Jersey. Visit rcgc.edu to register.
Welcome back to RCGC Today. We're going to take you now to KatoriCon, the little anime convention with a big heart, held on Rowan College at Gloucester County's campus for the past 8 years.
RCGC Today is on location at Rowan College at Gloucester County Sewell campus for KatoriCon, an annual anime convention and charity fundraiser run by the students of the college's Japanese Anime Guild. And you've never seen a fundraiser quite like this.
KatoriCon is a student-run charity fundraiser that is run by students in the Japanese Anime Guild, and we have run it every year since 2010. And the students help organize it, they get experience running a big event, and it attracts a lot of kids from the area who've never been to an anime convention, and it's a celebration of Japanese culture. It's the music, the books, the cartoons, it's everything dealing with Japanese culture, plus we expand a little bit into sort of Asian culture in general and some of the comic book culture. So we started out pretty small with just a few hundred people came, which surprised us. We even got that many the first time. And we peaked at 1,500. KatoriCon has the advantage of being in January when there's not a lot going on, so lots of people come. But it's also in January when the weather can be bad. And unfortunately this year we got hit with a bad snowstorm on Saturday. Our attendance was down, I guess, about a third this year because of the snow. But I can say the people that came, like, really made the best of it. They had a really good time. They didn't let the snow get in their way. They still had all their costumes on. All our guests made it. Even though our numbers were down of people, we made almost as much money, about 90% of the money that we would normally make for charity. We still were able to pull in. So I was pleased. But there was a lot of snow.
Seeing that many happy people in an event and being dedicated enough to come in the snow is pretty satisfying to see.
The majority of people are the kids and their parents from the area, but there's also a lot of people in their 20s come. We've had couples come in their 70s and just wander around and have fun. And we get people mainly from the surrounding area, South Jersey, Philly, but some people drive from upstate New York, some people drive from Boston, some come up from Baltimore, so they come from a wide variety of locations. I think a lot of people come because it is small, it's friendly. A lot of people have come since our very first year because they made friends then. You can meet the guests. We bring in actors, we bring in musicians, performers, artists, and they can actually spend time talking to them. So I think that's part of it. But I think a lot of the reason has to do with it's a charity fundraiser, and a lot of people want to help other people. They want to support the charities. We have 7 charities we were raising money for this year, and so each charity will be getting $1,000, but one charity is the RCGC Foundation. We're an endowing a scholarship, so we'll be putting a couple of thousand towards that endowment. And then the other charities is quite a wide variety. The students select all the charities, so they pick what they're interested in, and they pick a few local things, and they pick some big international charities.
When I know the money goes to something worthwhile, it makes me want to put more work into it.
One of the ones that they've supported for years has been Liberty in North Korea. And Liberty in North Korea helps rescue somebody who's escaping from the North Korean regime and gets them to safety. And we actually raised enough money to rescue a woman and from North Korea.
We send a bunch of money to charities that I personally believe in, like Link, Liberty in North Korea, freeing people from North Korea and sending them to somewhere that isn't a terrible place.
We also have bands. We pull in Japanese bands. Bands have flown from Japan for specifically to come to KatoriCon. We bring in actors who do the voiceovers in English for the Japanese anime.
My favorite thing is usually meeting the Team Rocket crew. Michelle Knotts, Jamie McGonigal, James Carter Cathcart. It's usually fun meeting them.
We have a lot of artists, and the artists will be here selling their artwork, but they can also interact with
people and talk to them about the work they're doing. We bring in dealers that will be selling things that you really can't easily get online, and we try to promote dealers' booths for businesses in the area. The Dragon Jedi have come every year for many years, and they dress in costume from Star Wars characters, and they do a demonstration showing their sword play with their lightsabers, and then they recruit new members while they're here as well, so people can join them. We had a demonstration of a Kung Fu martial arts club that's from the area, and it was run by one of our students, and the student's very active. He started up a martial arts club on campus as well and brought in the kids. They did a really cool little demonstration of some of the stuff they were learning.
The biggest and my most favorite part is the charity auction. We get a lot of donations from bands and people that we invite, and we auction them off to go to charities.
My favorite event at KatoriCon is the charity auction. We have all of our artists and our vendors will donate items to the charity auction. We'll have some of our special guests, they'll make up special items or they will autograph items for the charity auction. And it is co-hosted by one of our own faculty, Owen Canarney, who teaches art, so he can talk a lot about the art side of things. He's a very good auctioneer. And the other person who hosts it is Uncle Yo, who is a comedian who has come for several years, and he can understand where the pieces come from, what it has to do with the anime culture, and can help sort of raise the money. People are very supportive of the auction, so generous. It's always a delight to see what goes for and what people are excited about at the auction each year. There's a lot of people in costumes when you come to KatoriCon. A lot of people come in cosplay, as sometimes they're characters from Japanese cartoons, anime. Sometimes they are your Marvel characters or your DC characters, or they could be Harry Potter and Doctor Who. It's just a whole variety of costumes. So you see a lot of happy people in costume.
It's kind of like going to a carnival or a circus. You get to see things you don't normally see in everyday life.
We took a few moments at KatoriCon to visit with Sarah Palmer of Liberty in North Korea and RCGC's Amanda Chandler, who interned with LINK, to learn more about the important work of this organization.
My organization, Liberty in North Korea, believes that the North Korean people will achieve their liberty in our lifetime. The North Korean government has tried to maintain control of the people by creating an information blockade. No foreign media or international calls are allowed, for instance. There's also a really horrible system of oppression through collective punishment. So if you were to speak out against the government, you and your entire family could be sent to a political prison camp, face torture, sometimes even execution. And so a lot of lack of freedom in North Korea. And we work primarily by rescuing North Korean refugees who have fled into China. We work with partners in China and help them make the 3,000-mile rescue journey to safety and freedom. They go through Southeast Asia, where they meet with our field coordinators, and then they go on to resettle to places like South Korea or the United States. And from there, we also help them adjust in their resettlement and become empowered to be advocates or just to, yeah, adjust to their new lives. We've been doing rescues since 2010, and we've been able to bring out 542 brave individuals.
Their mothers, their sisters, their brothers. They go through the same struggles, they go through the same challenges that you do. You know, they just happen to be born in a country that doesn't really allow for them to see what the outside world is doing.
RCGC, through the Japanese Anime Guild Club and through events like this, have funded fully the rescue of Yusun, a woman in her late 30s, and she was actually able to come out, make the journey with her son, who's about 10 years old, and now they're living in safety and freedom in South Korea. So the community here has been responsible for bringing people to freedom and helping bring awareness to this issue that needs a lot more attention. If people want to get involved in supporting and standing alongside the North Korean people through our organization, there's a lot of different ways to get involved. One way, if you're a student here, would be to join up with the Japanese Anime Guild, see if you can co-host an event with them, support the events that they do to fund rescues. You can also, if you
maybe you don't have time to join another club, you can also get involved as an individual. So you can have an online fundraising page through this platform that we have. It's really shareable. It has a video about our work, and it shows which refugee we're funding for right now. And people can make online donations, PayPal donations. It's a really effective way to fund 100% for rescues. You can also become a monthly donor through our Liberty Monthly Donor Program. Donate around $15 a month, and that can go to support our work. You can intern with us in our South Korea office or in our Long Beach, California office. But even just spreading the word amongst your family and friends about the North Korean people, sharing a documentary, anything that you can do to spread the word is a great way to get involved.
What drew me to getting involved and, you know, trying to get the internship for Liberty North Korea was the fact that I didn't know. I felt as if I was doing a disservice to the world for not knowing this huge group of people who have such great potential but aren't able to really use it or to even know that they can use it, because they're, you know, in the society where if you have access to an Elvis Presley record, or if you have access to a USB drive that has new movies that are out, you know, you face imprisonment, your family faces imprisonment, your family's family, you know, faces imprisonment, and, you know, how could I have not known that? After I graduated from Rowan University, sort of like that gap year, if you want to call it, so I had planned to graduate December, January, if I was accepted for the internship, I was going to go get on a plane and fly to California. It's an intense training. So when I got there, because I was accepted, I got there, you know, you're immediately immersed into almost like a 12-hour workday where you're learning about the history of North Korea, you're learning about what Liberty in North Korea is actually doing, you're learning about the process that the organization does to help refugees out of China and into a resettlement process. You learn about that process. You even get to meet some of the refugees that the organization has rescued. So, you know, just amazing experiences. And then after about, I believe it was 5 weeks of training, you load the van and you set course for your journeys.
You get to live in an intern house, drive around in a Link van, come into the office, and not just like make copies or make coffee or do kind of busy work. You're really, doing the actual work of the organization, connecting with our supporters. If you speak Korean, that's always a plus, because you can work in translating or doing subtitles for documentaries and actually working directly with refugees who have resettled here too.
It's an internship. It's a nonprofit. You are paying for this internship yourself, but I did get people to donate to me, whether it was friends, family, and the Japanese Anime Guild, because it aligned with who they've donated to in the past. They actually made a gracious donation.
So today I've been at KatoriCon in the Artist Alley with a table selling water bottles and t-shirts, 100% of what goes to our work. And I also did a presentation sharing the stories of North Korean refugees and how people can get involved. This is my very first KatoriCon, which is awesome. I hope to come back in the future. It's a really fun event, and yeah, I'm really thankful to be here. It's really incredible to know that events like this all around the world are helping fuel rescues, helping bring people to freedom, and really changing people's perception about North Korea too.
That's all for this episode of RCGC Today. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.